Fighters.
How difficult was it at that time, Frank, for British fighters to get a world title shot?
It was quite difficult because there was only one champion, you know, one version of the title, which is a, you know, which is, and if you're frozen out and you haven't got the junior weights, you could wait, you could, your whole career could go past, yeah. and you don't get the opportunity to prove you're the best. But Harry said, you know, that Dave did get the opportunity, and he was very unlucky in that fight. But I think he's got to go in one of my top 10 British fighters. On my top 10, not one of the greats, but on the top 10 of one of them.
Other very popular British fighters from the period. Terry Downes first, Terry.
Oh, Downes is a great value fighter. I mean, a wonderful entertainer, great crowd pleaser and personality, and a damn good fighter as well. I mean, I think we tend to think of Downes just as a slam-bang tearaway man, but he wasn't. And if you look at his record, he actually outboxed Joey Ghirardello. And Ghirardello at the time was the uncrowned middleweight champion, and subsequently went on to beat Dick Tiger to become middleweight champion. And yet Downes comfortably outpointed him. So when Terry wanted to box, he really could box. But it's just that he loved to tear up. He's a, sort of the Nigel Benn of his day, wasn't he?
All boots, wasn't he? He was a real tough ex-Marine, US Marine. I mean, he was a real tough guy.
Was it a surprise that he couldn't hang on to the world title for longer?
Well, he was in a very tough era of middleweights. You know, there were only one of a dozen middleweights at that period who could deservedly have been champion. But Downes belonged there with them. I mean, Downes was one of the best men.
Pender wasn't
day.
A bad fighter, was he?
Pender beat Sugar Ray Robinson twice.
I mean, he was a good fighter. He went and had to go and fight. He fought him back in his hometown, didn't he, I think?
Yeah, and in Terry's last fight, he almost won the world light heavyweight title as well. Yeah. Fought Willie Pastrano, who was a wonderful craftsman. Yeah. And Downes was leading him for 10 rounds until he got stopped in the 11th.
One of Wales' finest, Harold Winston, again a world title holder for a very brief period.
Well, if we're talking terms of pure boxing, there's never been anybody to compare with Harold Winston for me. He was the greatest scientific boxer I'll ever see. A wonderful technician. Just didn't have the power to make him the all-round great fighter, but in terms of pure skill and technique and science, Winston was unmatchable.
Frank, your opinion?
Again, he had a tremendous jab. I mean, he could have been a trombone player, couldn't he? Because he was just that's what he used to fight with, that jab. But as Harry was saying, no power there. And he had a very short career, and which was a great shame, but he's certainly one of Wales's heroes.
Well, I think, too, he, like Dave Charnley, was unlucky to be contemporary of his great rival, Vicente Saldivar, who was one of the modern great featherweight champions. Howard fought him three times for the title and lost all three, the first two very, very close verdicts. I mean, in a different era, Howard would have won the world title and held on to it for a long time, I'm sure.
Wasn't it a bad decision or something in Wales, one of the fights?
No, I was lucky enough to see the two fights in this country, and Saldivar did win them both. Yeah. Not by much, but he did deserve to win them.
Glenn, at that period, do you think it was a more devastating result to lose a world title than it would be today?
I don't think so. Again, I think the public acclaim, you know, the spotlight, the media spotlight is so on a fighter now that you're almost washed up when you lose a fight. It's a real heavy, you know, everybody writes you off. Well, then, I don't think it was as bad, and, you know, sometimes you got clauses to fight again very quickly, and, you know, there was often, you know, fighters had boxed each other quite a few times, so you could get a go again. But I think the big thing is, in that era, a lot of it was luck. You know, if you were born at the wrong time, there was one champ in 8 divisions. It was, you know, sometimes it was just so hard to get another opportunity to get a title fight again.
Scotland did do much better with a couple of fighters from a slightly later period. Ken Buchanan, first up, Harry.
Well, Buchanan, for me, was the best pound for pound. I mean, I'm probably being premature with the verdicts here, but I can't think of any British fighter to match Ken Buchanan. You could send him anywhere in the world and he would win. I mean, he won his world title in Puerto Rico. He defended it in America, I think, two or three times. He was voted America's Fighter of the Year, topped the bill at Madison Square Garden 7 times, and beat Ali and Frazier in the voting for the Fighter of the Year in America in the year that he won it.
And yet he wasn't a big attraction here. He couldn't draw crowds here.
Why was that, Frank?
There was a little bit of dispute, I think, with the at the time. I think Jack Solomons was his promoter at the time. But he just didn't draw crowds, which was a great shame. He was not an attraction in this country.
I think, Frank, that may have been because his early career was spent mainly in the National Sporting Club, where he was a members-only club, and he was never given the chance to
show his talents. But to come back to this country come back to Great Britain, having won the title, and to, as you say, to do it in Puerto Rico, and to come back here and not become an attraction is crazy. I mean, we talk about there wasn't a lot of TV in those days, but what there certainly was, there was radio. And even more so, the newspapers. There was, for example, in evening newspapers would carry about four or five editions, and everything was boxing. There was a lot of space for boxing in those days. Nowadays you don't get a lot of space in newspapers for boxing. You get it for the big fights, but the smaller shows hardly get any coverage. But in those days, everything, anything that moved got written about. And I think that Ken Buchanan just was not an attraction here.
I think that could have been pretty much down to his style. I think as a boxer, I mean, he also punched well. He was just, in some ways, he was too good for his own good, because he was just an absolute master technician and so fast. I mean, I must admit that my father, who he happens to be a little bit older than me, he actually thinks Randall certainly thought was a great fighter, but he thinks that Ken Buchanan was the best British fighter that he ever saw.
Tell me this, Buchanan, a world champion who maybe didn't catch fire at the box office. Jim Watt certainly was successful at the box office, Harry. What was the difference between those two?
The difference probably was one of management and presentation. Yeah. Watt was a good fighter in his own right, of course, but he was also brilliantly managed and promoted, and came through at the right time after Duran, who incidentally regarded Ken Buchanan as the toppest man he'd ever fought. That's a tribute worth having, isn't it? Watt was lucky enough to come through after Duran had moved up to welterweight, and Watt picked up the lightweight title then. And defended it surprisingly well. I mean, a lot of us at the time thought he was a lucky guy who happened just to come along and benefit from Duran moving up. But he proved a very good fighter, and he beat two outstanding American challengers in Sean O'Grady and Howard Davis. And he wasn't supposed to win those fights. I mean, particularly the Davis fight. Davis was the golden boy of American boxing and was expected to transfer.
He wasn't a young man when he won the title. Was he 32 years of age?
He moved
from one manager to another manager, to Terry Lawless, I think, when he was about 30 years of age. So it came late in his career, and he certainly handled it very well.
But Jim, a particularly bright man, Glenn, one has the idea that maybe Jim applied plenty of good reasoning to how he would develop his career.
Sure.
His shortcomings in the ring were sorted out. Is that fair?
I would think so. I think he was a sensible man who maybe knew his limitations, knew his good points, and worked them to the best advantage in his career, and had a successful career, as you see, at the tail end of his career. But getting back to Ken Buchanan, I think what he did with Roberto Duran, and this is a peak Roberto Duran in his lightweight days, not the guy who beat Iron Barkley decades later when he was still a great fighter. This is when Duran was at his peak and was unbeatable. He was beaten then off Duran in very controversial circumstances. I think Duran maybe just hit him a little bit south of the border and was a little bit rough in that thing. Otherwise, he could well have beat Duran.
And thereby hangs another tale. We'll take a short break, and when we come back, we'll be reviewing British world champions from the 70s and 80s. See you in just a moment. Hello there again. We're debating the merits of British boxers throughout the century, trying to find out the finest produced in Britain in the history of the sport. Frank Warren and Glenn McCrory, joined by Harry Mullen. It's been an interesting discussion so far. No firm conclusions to report, as you probably are aware. Harry, one man from the 60s that we should mention before we move on to the more recent past, Walter McGowan, completing a trio of Scottish world champions from that period. But like the others, he couldn't really dominate his division for a long span, could he?
Well, Walter was a brilliant boxer, but he was severely handicapped by a tendency to cut, which cost him his world championship in his first defence and cost him several other important fights in his career. I think had he had, like Henry Cooper, you know, had he had stronger eyebrows, he would have been a much better fighter and a more complete fighter. But on his night, you know, on the night that he beat Biruni for the world title at Wembley, he was wonderful.
Yeah, it's just a shame. That was, as Harry says, the eyes were a problem for him, the cuts. And I believe he would have gone to be one of the greats.
Wasn't really a vintage period, the 60s, was it, Frank?
It was exciting times, but we didn't. I don't think there was any champion that managed to defend his title successfully. And we just didn't seem to do it. Downsy, exciting, a lot of exciting fighters there, and Terry Downs and so forth, but we just didn't do it.
British boxing.